Excuse me, sir. Excuse me, sir. More things, sir. Thank you. Excuse me, sir. Excuse me, sir.
happen when people and their pets are cooped together. Love that story. And if you can't watch us live, don't forget to set your DVR so you can watch us later. That is tonight's CBS Evening News. I'm Laura O'Donnell. We'll see you right back here tomorrow. Stay safe and good night. Coronavirus testing issues. Why the number of positive cases could be much higher than we know. Stay-at-home orders. What options do police officers have when it comes to enforcement?
I'm not standing outside making noise because it's fun.
Making a request to what local renters are asking of their city and state. So tracking the numbers off the top, here we go. As of 5 p.m., the state is now reporting 1,802 confirmed and probable cases of coronavirus. 36 of those cases were reported today. Statewide, there have been 54 deaths, and 767 people have recovered from it. With so many people out of work, the thought of paying rent or being evicted is a major concern. CBS 2 Kaylee Kramer talked to members of Boise Renters United and the mayor about what needs to be done to ease the burden on tenants.
Even before this current crisis, tenants in Boise were, you know, facing a housing affordability crisis and whatnot. And so the current pandemic, as well as the resulting economic effects, have, you know, only exacerbated the hardships.
Boise Renters United wrote Mayor McQueen a letter last week demanding the city enact a full moratorium on all evictions, cancel rent, and provide humane emergency housing for all people without homes so that they can social distance.
Maybe now that there is an issue of crisis, a need is enough to not require us to have those solutions. But I think encouraging us to have this, to come up with them, to figure out how to get from here to a rent freeze, to a suspension or cancellation of rent and moratoriums, which is based on the fact of recognizing, and this is our point, that people and housing are intertwined with our health and safety of the community, and that the economics of our community, frankly, are.
They say the mayor responded to their letter saying the city has no legal authority to cancel rent or put a moratorium on eviction.
Without invoking martial law, we are, I do not have the authority to halt eviction. And I haven't seen, it takes a lot to decide that you're going to invoke police powers or martial law. We did it specifically to curbing the spread of the virus, and not invoking martial law, but using emergency powers for health emergency. And the closure of the court prevented the filing of evictions for the time being. And we as a city, where we could, stop evictions in the properties that we own.
Last night, individual members of Boise Renters United held a short noise demonstration outside of the mayor's home during the city council meeting to show continued support for the demands in the original letter.
I'm not standing outside of making noise because it's fun or I want to, or because it's a great communication tool, right? I think it's because we attempted to take a systemically improved approach to communication, and the result was satisfactory, and the timeline systemic approach takes is not appropriate for what's happening right now. And so to go and be disruptive for 10 minutes and respect and like responsibly leave, that's an attempt to invite conversation.
McLean says she appreciated the way protesters peacefully called attention to their cause, but as the affordable housing issue isn't something the city can tackle renter by renter, and they're focusing on moving housing policy forward.
Affordability is an issue because our wages haven't kept up with our tax revenue. And often, I've said to somebody before, all those issues that we're becoming a parent are, you know, are even more exacerbated by this crisis and becoming an essential that many of our residents are experiencing in the past year. And we are going to aggressively make sure, one, that we put policy in place and increase the number of affordable units.
In Boise, Haley Kramer, CBS 2 News.
Meanwhile, for some homeowners, there may be relief. Millions of Americans are putting their home loans into forbearance. A government program allows them to delay or reduce mortgage payments if the pandemic is affecting their income. Participating homeowners are not responsible for interest on federally backed loans for 1 year. Local police departments meantime facing more challenges and protests over Idaho state and direct assault. The latest happened last night in Meridian. Another protest will happen tonight in Boise. In the meantime, parks appear to be open, at least in Meridian, but there are rules to be followed. And CBS 2's Brian Moore talked to the Meridian police chief about how they are enforcing the orders.
I can't wait to get back to the game. What can and can't we do? Let's find out.
This is a bit confusing at Settlers Park in Meridian. There are people walking their dogs, looking for a new job. They appear to be 6 feet apart. The ducks and geese don't seem to mind. It was supposed to be different, but it's a good thing going running. At the playground, it gets real. The equipment is marked off with caution tape. A little funny makes it too lonely these days. Some friends in the parking lot hanging out, but they do seem to be following social distancing guidelines. So what are we supposed to be doing? Can anybody here get in trouble?
Well, that's a good question. And so what we've done to help educate the public at our parks is we've put signs on the restrooms and we locked the doors. We put signs on the playground equipment and we taped them off. So an obvious person would know, reading the signs and looking at the tape, that it's closed. Everything else in the park is open.
The softball fields are not marked off. No caution tape here. You can certainly practice and stay more than 6 feet apart. However, what if you put a whole team on the field? Could police step in? What would happen?
Yeah, I guess the thing that we would like the public to know is, if in doubt, reach out and ask the question. We have people in the past that is this open? Is this closed? We've done a frequent asked questions thing on our Facebook page as far as, is this business open? Is this business closed? Can this business do this? Can you modify that? We're doing everything in our community to answer travel people.
So exercising common sense is like, stay at home. Stay in school. Stay out of trouble. In Meridian, Brian Moore, CBS 2 News.
And new 5:30 new autopsy results show the first known coronavirus deaths in the country actually happened in Santa Clara, California. 3 weeks earlier, the first thought to be the first reported death in Kirkland, Washington. So the medical examiner now says the Californians likely contracted the virus from community spread.
So with three of them that told us that, there must have been... It was really difficult, remember, we had a robust influenza season, so it would have been extraordinarily difficult to pick out what was influenza and what was COVID-19.
This adjusted start to the timeline has many concerned about what could happen in the future. Could there be a possible second outbreak? Well, some epidemiologists are saying the number of positive cases is probably much higher than we know. They say it's hard to know just how big that number actually is due to limited testing. Another issue, false negatives. Some laboratory scientists are finding flaws in their testing process, and until more tests are developed, some medical experts believe we won't know the true scale of these silent infections.
So we need to develop a test that has high levels of effectiveness and high levels of reliability. Rushing to make these tests can lead to a lot of false positives and negatives, and that can be detrimental. Many people believe that they're okay, but...
Another big issue, asymptomatic carriers. A new study from the CDC suggests 25% of those infected may never know they even had it and could have spread it. A virtual town hall is happening tonight. It's in Blaine County. This is an area of the state hit especially hard by the coronavirus. CBS 2's Scott Lewis tells what we can expect to learn.
This second virtual town hall at 6:30 this evening will include topics related to reopening parts of the economy, the implications for public health, and available financial and economic relief and recovery programs. Blaine County residents will have the opportunity once again to listen in and ask questions directly to community and health leaders on the latest local COVID-19 updates and response measures. People can connect to the virtual town hall by first registering online before the meeting. Go to the Blaine County website homepage at www.blainecounty.org. Click on the COVID-19 updates and frequently asked questions button Then click on the virtual town hall register button. After entering name and email address, registrants will be able to receive an email invitation with instructions how to connect online or by telephone. Scott Logan, CBS 2 News.
Well, as I indicated, another protest is happening tonight in Boise. This one will be taking place at Philippi Park at 6 p.m. People are protesting the removal of basketball rims and hoops from the city courts. And Governor Brad Little will hold a live news conference tomorrow. You can watch it here on CBS 2 and idlenews.com. It's at 11 in the morning, again, tomorrow. The topic will be economic recovery here in the Gem State. CBS 2 will also provide coverage of the recovery during the newscast tomorrow afternoon. Well, coming up all new on CBS 2 News at 5:30, distance learning. It's the new norm for most kids. How one rural Idaho school is learning and adapting. CBS 2 and Mountain America Credit Union, we're so proud to be giving out shout-out to locally owned businesses. Here we go. Cherished Images Fine Art Photography has a free special for local small businesses with brick-and-mortar storefronts. To read more about this special or to buy a gift card, just go online. The links to this business and others can be found on idahonews.com. Together with you, we're supporting small business.
Today's market report is sponsored by your local Edward Jones Financial Advisors. With more than 50 offices in the Treasure Valley, Edward Jones, making sense of investing, member SIPC.
Over 45 years, we've known our customers are the most important asset, and we're open for all of your essential needs. Choose from over 2,000 RVs, side-by-sides, motorcycles, boats, and accessories, with incredible offers like 0% financing, huge discounts off MSRP, top value for any trade, and free storage with any purchase. Denniston RV Marine Power Sports. Log in at DDRV.com or visit us here at 6772 Tarpeyan, Boise.
Your bank can be virtually any place you are. You can deposit checks from here, and you can do your transactions and check your balance from here, and pay bills from here. Because your bank isn't just one place. It's virtually any place you are. Just download and use the Chase mobile app. Visit chase.com/mobile.
Coming together makes us stronger, and Ford is built to lend a hand. Contact your Ford dealer, an essential part of your community, to find out more about home delivery and other vehicle service options. After all, you have a lot to take care of. Let us help take care of you. Find out more at Ford.com. Now get 0% financing for up to 84 months with 3 months deferred across Ford's complete lineup. That's just part of how your local Ford stores are built to lend a hand.
It's not too late to complete the census. Visit 2020census.gov today.